any one of the anaerobic waste products, you've got to get another layer of your aerobic compost material on top of that pile, because we don't want to lose the nutrients. We didn't have to wait long enough for the static pile. For all those organisms in the middle of the pile working on those high nitrogen materials, on our food waste material, on our, but off in the middle of a static pile, you're going to be putting a couple of dead cows, these, you know, 2,000 dead chickens, turkeys, so meat, carcasses of animals that have died. Very often that's what we use static composting for, because there's no way to prevent those materials from becoming anaerobic as they go through a composting process. So in the middle of that pile, we have those really most likely to go anaerobic materials in the middle of the pile. And you have to wait until the microorganisms have had their party and all the party foods are gone. So all that high nitrogen has to be utilized, all those anaerobic processes have to occur. And then oxygen will start diffusing back into the middle of that pile. And so when you go to take your static compost pile down, the easiest way to figure out whether it's time to be taking your pile down is as you're digging into that pile, you don't smell any stink. The second you smell stink, you back out, close it back up again, don't come back for a couple more months. So hot compost or thermal composting, warm composting, cold composting. And there are different ways to do thermal and worm, so we're going to be talking about all of those subsets of things. So large-scale composting. Typically, the recipes for these piles are going to be very similar to the recipes that we're going to be using in backyard composting. And so typically a pile like this, we're going to lay down the woody materials on the bottom. Because if any of our other starting materials have moisture in them, we don't want to be contaminating our ground. And having E. coli or salmonella or shigella or something really horrific moving into the soil itself. So we're going to put the woody materials on the bottom typically as that bottom layer. So, like a pile we made yesterday, 40% flower species, waxy leaved. And that waxy coat has to get decomposed first. So the C-N ratio on these waxy materials may be greater than 100, but it's because of the wax. So think of that leaf surface. So there's our leaf. It has a nice waxy coated, high carbon, very hydrophobic. Water runs off, doesn't absorb. We have to get the organisms in here that chew up that wax. And not until they move through that wax do you get to the green part of the leaf. So if you use a lot of banana leaf in your piles, you may see a real slow increase in your temperature. It may even kind of level off for a couple days, and then all of a sudden, woo! Off goes your temperature. Wow! Surprise, and it bursts into flames because you didn't expect it. So how do we know this happens? So what's happening is you've got to have the fungi in your pile to chew through that waxy material. And then the bacteria go gangbusters. And there are some instances where this is really more like high nitrogen containing material. You can have so much nitrogen in that green center part of the leaf that acts like a high nitrogen, just like manure, just like a legume. And so you can get a lot of heat released as the morning cycle as your bacteria start growing on that center part of the leaf. So be prepared. You really might want to take those banana leaves and chip them up. Because if you chip this up, then your bacteria are getting to that center green stuff right away. And you have to have a fungi to chew up that, those waxy layers. So if you're going to be doing waxy leaf material, please make sure that you have a fungi in your pile, or you're going to be ending up with residues that are not decomposed during that composting process.
Wouldn't you chip up most of the compost then?
I think it would be a good idea to chip up most of the compost materials. It's going to go much faster if you do chip too much. Here's the trade-off. So we want chunks that are, you know, like a half inch to an inch in size, but chunked up. Don't leave your banana leaves these big, long things and throw them into the pile. I love it when I tell people to put straw or hay into the pile, and they leave the body of that grassy material unchopped up. Well, yeah, just try turning that pile. Enjoy yourself. You get to clean up all that long, those long strands of grass or straw wrap around your turner, and then you got to take your people and you got to be cleaning out your turner. This is not fun, and it's very expensive, really, to have your help doing that kind of thing. Questions?
How does the best small plays you got to get your stuff to chip it up? You run over the lawnmower or what?
Yeah, any way you can find to chip it up. So running over with a lawnmower is maybe one way, although a lawnmower tends to kind of spread it, and I've got to pick it back up. What I find more useful is to take all of my material, my grassy material, anything that's not woody, and actually put it into one of those plastic barrels, and take my weed whacker and just whack that material until it gets down to a small enough size. Now, don't try that with your woody stuff, because your weed whacker just breaks. So with woody things, what I do in my backyard is to just collect all my woody prunings, all the branches, all the larger chunks of things. And I have more trees than you want to talk about in my backyard, so I never have a problem with supply. But now we're in my homeowners association, finally gets around to saying, please clean up your pile of wood chip stuff. It looks bad. It's not allowed. It's time to go chip that up. So I go rent a chipper for a morning and just stand out there and nice, pretty pile of wood chips. I usually inoculate my wood chip pile right away with really good fuzzle materials. Because as that wood chip pile sits there, and I'll slowly use it over the next 6 months or so to make my compost piles. Then that those woody materials get very, very fungous with the best fungi you want to talk about. And so we're already going into my pile. Huge diversity, good fungi, no problem getting the fungal materials in my pile decomposed. There was another question. There's a hand to go. Yep.
So, how big is your pile? And does the center go anaerobic? Or are you using it and then oxygen?
So let's say we have windrows like this. So I was starting to go through the recipe. So the bottom layer, typically the woody stuff. And then the next layer, I will either put in my green material or my high nitrogen. So next layer, let's say green. So I'm going to put, you know, maybe 35% green. So this is the woody is fungal foods. Green is bacterial food, so I'm looking at C-to-N ratio on that green of about 30-1. And then the top layer is going to be my high nitrogen. This is my party food, and I only want to put enough party food in here. So I get the temperature to stay up high enough temperature long enough to meet regulations, and then I want that party food to run out, have the party end. You all have to go home at midnight, I'm sorry. No later. And so that's the real tricky part about a compost pile, is finding out about your high nitrogen. Is it going to really provide you enough nitrogen, enough party? Or there really wasn't enough oomph in there and you should have put more. So these little piles like this that we're starting out with is a really good way to test what your source of high nitrogen is. So I don't know if anybody's gone out there and tested the temperature in the compost pile yet this morning. No, so at break time, let's poke David and get him to go out and take the temperature. Because yesterday it was 100 degrees. I would hope that it'd be up around 120, 130 if that manure was adequate to give us the party food to get those bacteria and fungi growing. So, you know, in this pile, we're at 75%, so 25% high nitrogen. So the things we're looking for here are legumes. So grow a field of alfalfa, grow a field of clover, grow some peas, grow some beans, and then go harvest the top part of the plant. Please make sure to check your roots and make certain that you've got nitrogen fixing nodules on those legumes. No point in wasting your time composting if you don't know that this alfalfa actually has high levels of nitrogen. Could you buy a bill of alfalfa? Well, how do you know that that alfalfa actually has nodules on it that is actually high nitrogen? When I've gone to the store, went to the feed store and bought bales of alfalfa, probably about 25% of the time that alfalfa is actually high nitrogen. The other 75% of the time, it was green stuff. And the way I can tell is the way the pile reacted. We didn't get enough heat, we didn't generate temperature, we had to start over.
Food waste?
No, most food waste is vegetable material. So green, now what if you put meat in? What percentage of your food waste material is meat?
5%.
So for example, at Rodale, we take food waste material from the local town. And I'll talk about some of our experiences. So right after Thanksgiving, here we get this load of food waste coming from the hospital, from the high school, from Rodale Press. And a couple other small restaurants in town. And in this material, they come with their 4-ton truck. It's filled up to the top. They just, you know, open up the bag and tilt it out into our bowl of dry material that we try to capture. There were 120 full-size, completely intact turkey carcasses. Oh, shit. Because what's that gonna do to my recipe? Now my recipe of dry, woody material, green stuff, completely wrong. When we've got that much high nitrogen, turkey carcasses, what is that? Meat, intact. Why didn't they send this? Why didn't they take those carcasses? Because they were still in the plastic.
Oh my God.
Why didn't they take them to the food shelter? Why didn't they feed them to somebody who needed Thanksgiving dinner? No, we got them. How many of you want to wade into food waste and take the plastic off those turkeys? Man, I was so angry at those guys. You get your waders on and you get in there and your plastic, you know. Man. There are some real hazards when it comes to accepting large quantities of food waste from people. And we really have to change our requirements. We can't just throw stuff into a container and then ship that off to the farm. Do not accept materials from anywhere where you as a farmer can't require that they do it right. My attitude was, no, you know, cuts down, you come back out here and you take this stuff because you violated our agreement. No plastic is supposed to come in the food waste material. So we gotta change that process of sending food waste to farms because that was just a mess. But we got really hot really fast in that compost pile and we had to be out there turning those piles 2 times a day, every day for the next 7 days because of that high nitrogen. So food waste, define what it is very carefully. If you make an agreement with somebody about taking their food waste, be adamant about no plastic. The second a spoon is found in there, they got to take it back. And stick by your guns. Because unless you stick by your guns on this one, they're going to walk all over you. There's a question?
Yeah, couldn't you just say, okay, we got a scattered pile here, cover it?
We don't have that kind of property. Rodale isn't that large. So we had to do the turning thing. And it just, those piles of compost cost us way more. So we're in deficit now in our composting operations. We had to spend way too much time and money and gas and wear and tear. And other question in here? Okay, so food waste horror stories. Legumes, manure, meat, Now, I look at manure as any kind of manure coming out of an animal. I don't see why we can't compost cat and dog and horse and pig and llama and Komodo dragon and anything you want to talk about. It's manure. It's high nitrogen. How high nitrogen? Guess what? All manures do not come with the same amount of high nitrogen. So when you're looking at a cow, what does a cow eat?
Grass.
If you've got a cow that's eating grass,
I'm sorry, those.
It doesn't have as much high nitrogen coming down the other end. So if I'm looking at a recipe like the one I just gave you, I definitely would use 25% of my pile of high nitrogen with cow manure. Chicken manure. What do we feed chickens?
High protein.
What do we feed chickens?
Corn.
Seed. We feed them grain. What's the seed-in ratio of a seed?
5.
Hi, it's 10 to 1. What's the seed-in ratio of grass?
100.
So they eat green grass, hopefully. They do get some straw, but it doesn't do much. But chickens, high nitrogen source. I would never put 25% of pure chicken manure into a compost pile because I really don't want to be turning that often. So in that same recipe, I would probably only use 15% chicken manure because this is so much higher nitrogen. So then we've got another 10%. What do we, you know, if we've got 40% woody, we've got 35% green, and then 15% high nitrogen, what's my other 10%? We'll split it between the two. So make it 50% woody, 40% green, 15% high nitrogen, and now you're going to come out with a pretty good pile that's going to turn at pretty normal times. What if your chicken manure comes mixed with wood? Just like here, the chickens were on a bedding material. Well, then you got to guesstimate. What's the percent of actual manure? How much chicken pee went into the wood chips and has been soaked up by the wood chips? Isn't that a fun question to try to figure out? So you're always going to make the test pile. The first time you start with something new, test it and learn about that source. So am I putting 15% pure chicken manure? Oh, it's already coming with 10% woody. So now 25% chicken manure with woody. When you look at pig manure, what do we feed pigs? Now, so here's it depends. Look at the kind of garbage you're feeding your pigs. And if there's meat going in there, then you probably could only use somewhere around 5% pig manure if they're fed meat, meat byproducts, parts of other animals. It's going to be high nitrogen. Human manure. What are you humans eating?
Omnivores.
Yeah. Well, what if you're a vegetarian? If you're a vegetarian, your manure is just like a cow. If you're mostly a meat eater, look out. Can't use much. So look at what your animals are being fed and now start making some changes in the amount of that material based on, what is that food resource? Is this party food? Or is it party food? Which one is it? And adjust your percentages when you're going into your recipes. Question?
When you say test, you just need to get a check.
Right? Yep, on these ones. And you might be doing a little bit of microscope work to make sure your pile is staying aerobic. If you get too much nitrogen in there and those guys start having too big a party, you're going to go anaerobic. And now you're looking for the filamentous fungi and you're looking for your ciliates. Because that would tell you.
Well, with all of those, the age is also important. If it's fresh off the cow or if it's been sitting in a paddock for 6 months.
Yep, good point. So I'm assuming here that this is pretty fresh material. What if your chicken manure has been sitting around underneath your chicken house for 6 months? Happily evolved to live pneumonia. And every time you pass by your chicken coop, you got, oh, she has such stinky animals. handling the manure. How many of you have ever walked into the basement, the bottom floor of a hen layer house, a commercial hen house? It will knock your socks off because the ammonia smell is so horrific. I feel really sorry for those hens because they'll have the cages layered, about 10, 12 layers of chickens. So imagine being a chicken in the bottom cage. You are living in fecal rain your whole entire life. And the smell coming from the stuff on the bottom is just awful. I try not to eat commercially raised chicken eggs because it's so sorry for the animals and the way we treat them. I like organic chicken eggs, please.
If you have rabbits and you're feeding them a lot of lambs and grass,
yep. Rabbit poop tends to be a lot like a cow. Even when you're feeding them a lot of legumes, it doesn't seem to come out really high in nitrogen. Don't quite know why yet, but you know, I don't know everything yet. Thank goodness. There are still things I need to test, figure out. Okay, so doing a test pile, see what effect this is going to have.
You mentioned the precautions or considerations when dealing with human manure.
I will go through that.
Okay.
With human manure, the major problem is it's going to come packed with pathogens. You must make that assumption. Even though most of the people contributing to your human manure pile are probably healthy, what if you didn't know that somebody's coming down with typhoid, cholera, the plague, something? You really want to take that attitude that it's just terrible stuff and you're going to have to do your absolute best to make sure that that's all properly dealt with. Temperature. And that's why we have to get all parts of the pile up to high enough temperatures long enough so we know any potential problem is taken care of. Please note that E. coli, E. coli is not a human pathogen, or not a human pathogen until E. coli 0157H came out. This is a true pathogen all on its own. It is a human pathogen, all of a sudden, kind of out of the blue, back in the 1970s. We have E. coli that expressed the same toxin as you see in Salmonella, as you see for typhoid or typhus, one of those really nasty human diseases. So somehow or another, this strain of E. coli picked up that long sequence that codes for that toxin. And now we do have E. coli that are human pathogens, truly. But in the past, and usually, we use E. coli as an indicator that you could have, that you will, sometime in the not too distant future, have a true human pathogen show up. If E. coli can survive, then it is quite likely that if a human pathogen was in there, it too would be able to survive. So we're erring on the side of a little too strict, perhaps, but we don't want to play with this. We don't want people dying from using our compost. So it's got to get up to high enough temperature long enough to deal with this problem. So we're out there, we put in our woody layer, we put our green layer down, and we put our nitrogen. Well, can I put half my woody and then half my green, half my high nitrogen, and then the other half of my woody, the other half of my green, and the other half of the high? Sure. However you want to layer this, fine, with intermittent. Realize I don't see much point in leaving it unturned. Yeah, but if you want to, leave it till the next morning to turn it, fine, you know. So now we're going to come in here with our turner. In large scale operations like this one, you're going to have a turner of some kind. I recommend to you that you get turners that are actually going to take the material that's on the outer part of that pile. So there's my pile. You know, typically 8 feet tall is about as high as you want it to get. Although I work with growers, with compost makers in Texas, that they have the largest turner in the world, and they make their piles 16 feet tall.
Is that inflated?
They just end up turning it more often, that's all.
Is that inflated?
Hmm?
Is that inflated?
No, it's in Austin, yeah. Well, there's another one down in San Antonio. So there's a couple of them. They split off. And so, so about 8 feet tall for a turnaround about like this. When you're looking at the height here, you want a good 2 to 3 feet between the top of the pile and the turner, because you've got to throw that compost up in the air and it has to settle down. You want to be able to spray water, so you're looking at water jets here across the top, because the best way to wet up your compost is as all those little bits and pieces are flying through the air. If you put a sprinkler down the top of this compost pile, it just won't work. It's not going to wet up that pot. If there are any hydrophobic areas where some part of the pile got a little bit dry, the water's just going to passively move around it, and you end up with puddles in between your windrows. If you're luckier than that, all of your water stays in the top of the windrow, so the only place you have decomposition is occurring is right here at the top. Well, when we're putting our thermometers into our compost piles, we're putting our thermometers in there, assuming that this middle of the pile is where the highest temperature is. So I was working with people in Australia, and I didn't realize that they were just running a pipe across the top of their windrow. So here's their water tank. Pipe went out, and they were just watering their windrows from the top. And I was going down their rows, pointing into the middle, going, you're only at 45 degrees, or 45 degrees Celsius, which is about 125 degrees Fahrenheit. And you're not composting at all. You can't sell this stuff. It's not done. It's not even beginning to compost. Yes, it is. Look at how much it's steaming. Steam and whether you're at temperature have nothing to do with each other. Steam just tells you that there's a significant difference between the temperature in the pile and the outside temperature. That's all that means. The pile is at least 25 degrees different temperature than outside. So don't be concerned when it's steaming, doesn't mean anything. So they're turning the piles now, and as they're turning the piles, it's coming out black. So how can something that's at 125 degrees Fahrenheit be going anaerobic? What is going on? And I'm looking at that turner going through the pile and just makes no sense. Some part of this pile is up extremely high temperature. It's going anaerobic. And this pile is in imminent danger of going kaboom. What's going on? So I get in front of the turner. Take my thermometer, so I'm going to go to the top of the pile, put my thermometer on the top of the pile, and go right on through and find out where the hottest part of the pile is. So I'm climbing up the compost pile, get to the top, I'm about to put my thermometer into the top of the compost pile, and realize that my boots are burning. I left right away. And then you have to do detective work and find out how come the top part of your pile is so absolutely burning hot. This is at 178 degrees. Just try walking on that stuff. Because they were only watering that part of the pile. And none of that water was getting any deeper into the pile. So this wasn't composting, this was going anaerobic. Are they making good compost? So when you're watering, you want to water as this material is flying through the air. And you're going to bring that pile up to 50% moisture. As you're walking along, first thing in the morning typically, go in and point towards what you think is the hottest part of the pile. But do a little investigation. You know, maybe the first couple ones you kind of move it around a bit. And then you go down a little bit further and take that temperature. Well, while you're taking that temperature, move over a couple of feet, stick your hand into the pile, go down about 2 feet, about the same place you're taking your temperature. Grab a handful and test it. Do we need to be adding water or not? If my pile's getting too dry, I'm not going to be composting temperature, it's going to be hoppy. So you better get in there and turn it and add moisture. if the temperature on my pile is getting too hot, I need to get in there and turn it. The moisture needs to stay around 50%, 40-60% in thermal compost. And I want to turn it every time it gets up to temperature. I want to turn it every time it starts getting too dry. When I'm digging into my pile and I see that layer of actinobacteria starting to form, I want to turn it. Because despite everything else that we think is going on, that actinobacteria is telling us that it's going anaerobic. So we got to turn it. Now, in a turner like this, the cylinder has a set of teeth on it, and it goes around in a spiral pattern. So from both sides, you have an S shape, a sinusoidal set of teeth that moves this material on the sides into the middle, from the sides into the middle. And then you have to have a set of flat teeth in the middle here, so the middle of the pile is thrown straight up into the air. And so in our, with our turner, as we're spraying water, these bits and pieces of your compost flying through the air, happily dropping to the sides, maybe rolling down, are all nicely wetted up, and that moisture moves in and penetrates through into the rest of the pile. So a couple days, you're going to be coming back through here and turning the pile again. So maybe what started out here on the edge moves into the middle. So what's on the edge of the first turn moves into the middle. Hopefully it's getting hot enough, long enough. You come in, now you're going to turn it again because it's been hot enough, long enough. And so this material is going to get thrown up into the air, so it's up here somewhere. And the next turn, it's going to be moving down here. So the effect of these turners is to have circulation in your pile over the course of a couple turns. It's going to make sure that everything gets into the middle of the pile. One critically important part of turning is that you do not forget this material down at the bottom. Many, many times I have been called into composting operations because they can get rid of the E. coli in their pile. They're doing the absolute best they can, but they're still coming up with 800 colony-forming units, 1,000 colony-forming units, 1,200. You can't get over that hurdle. And almost invariably, what's going on is they don't want to wear the teeth on their turner. And so they're not letting that turner cylinder get down far enough. And they're leaving that last inch or 2 inches of their compost pile unturned. Now, if they would not pick this material up, when they collect their compost pile, they probably would be okay. But of course, when you're going to go clear that pad of your compost, does the, the shovel guy forget to pick up the last 2 inches? It goes right into the pile. And then because the E. coli levels, human pathogen levels, are so high down here, it contaminates the rest of the pile. So as you're going through this windrow, you must be hearing the teeth on your turner. You must hear it clicking on the ground. You have to know that you're getting all the way down to that last bottom bit of your compost. This is why a lot of people, a lot of states, a lot of operations where if you sell compost, you have to compost on concrete or tarmac or asphalt. Because they want to make certain that you can hear those teeth clipping on the compost or on the concrete or whatever. If it's on soil the way it is here, how do you know that you've actually picked up the bottom of the pile? Every time you're turning, you're probably turning a little bit of your soil back into the compost pile. So now your compost isn't just organic matter. It's got some soil in there as well, which is okay. But probably you don't really want to be making a nice trench where you're trying to make compost.
If we're doing it in our yard, is there more concern? Because we put chip on the bottom too. When you remove it, you want to take out all the chip? or you want to make sure you're turning that chip into the pile when you're... Is E. coli, you know, I should ask you about E. coli, is E. coli itself, other than being just a marker, will it damage us if we use it and put it into our gardens or...
No, E. coli is pretty innocuous as long as you don't have that one particular pathogen.
Okay.
It's really just more of an indicator, yeah. But, you know, when you're on a wood chip base and you put your compost pile on there, you probably want to, as you're turning, you want to get a little bit of that base also turned in. Because you might have had E. coli go into that base material, and you do want to make sure that the other pathogens that might have been in there get destroyed as well. So every time you compost, you're probably going to want to replenish that base of wood chip material so you're not ending up composting in a hollow. Because with these compost piles, think about when it rains. If this compost pile is actually in a little divot, where's all your rainwater going to collect? And then your pile is constantly water saturated. You're not making compost, because if you have a water saturated pile, if it's soggy wet down there at the bottom and you don't know about it, then you're not making compost, you're making putrefied organic matter. So you do want to pay attention to what are you composting on, and make sure that you're getting down to the base, but you're not chewing up your base either. Large composting operations, everything they do probably have to be on a hard surface. So what are these guys doing to make certain that they're on a hard surface? Once a year they come in and when they finish making compost in a large section, like an acre area of their composting operation, they don't start any new piles. And instead, they'll come in with an application of lime and liquid ammonia. And those two things mixed together cause the soil surface to become just like concrete. So they are, in fact, composting on a concrete-like pad. If you want to learn what that recipe is with lime and the anhydrous ammonia, go to the information on the internet on how to make landing strips in jungle areas. That's what we did in World War I, World War II, where we're out trying to establish landing strips where you don't have concrete, you don't have an industry that allows you to put on tarmac or asphalt. We can very easily and very rapidly take any soil and turn it into concrete. It's not permanent, but it takes a long time to resuscitate once you've done that treatment. But it's great for a composting yard like this. So typically what way I like to set up yards like this is to have one or two people come out every morning, and they get out here pretty early. Because what they want to do is pull the covers off the compost piles that need to be tested. And they go down the line and test moisture and temperature. And you look for your actinobacteria. Does this windrow need to be turned? If it does, this windrow gets the red stake. And then you move on to the next windrow. Does this need to be turned? Maybe it's sort of on the edge. Maybe it could be turned. If you got time, guys, turn it. So it gets a yellow stake. The piles that don't need to be turned, leave them alone. Now they get a green stake. You don't have to touch them. And usually what I would ask is for them to come back on and put the covers back on all of those windrows that don't need to be touched today. These guys, because of where they are, know we're not going to get rain for about the next 3 months. So why cover? Well, on the other hand, if it's going to be a bright, sunshiny, hot day, and you're going to completely dry your compost out, it's really expensive to put that much water back into your pile. Cover it. Protect it from evaporation. Protect it from downpours, especially in this part of the world. You have a choice of two conditions in Hawaii, right? Downpour of rain or hot, sunshiny, evaporate everything. Those are your choices. Cover your pile. So you want to get a tarp. Large operation like this, typically the breathable felt fabric called Comtex, so that oxygen and CO2 will move through the tarp. The tarp sheds about 75-80% of water falling on it. And then you better make sure that your whole compost pad is slightly on a slope, so that as water falls in between compost windrows, the water is going to run off, not stay soaking your compost piles from the bottom and wicking them up. And that water needs to run off into a retention basin somewhere. You can use that water to water your windrows if you want. Just make sure that any of your manure piles are not contributing to that basin, or you're applying, maybe applying water that is contaminated with human pathogens. So quite generally, in a large composting operation like this, so if you look at a map from above, say, I want most of my windrows on a slope such that the retention pond, the water, all of these windrows, as rain falls, the water's going to run into that retention pond, weaken the water with it. But here's where my manure pile might be. Here's where my wood chip pile might be. And I want to make sure that any water that runs off from these piles are going to go into a real small pond that now I'm going to have to do something with it, water my manure pile with it, water my wood chip with it. But don't let it contaminate the pile, the pond, where I'm going to be watering almost finished piles. Another thing to always think about is, let me go through a typical day first. So measure temperature and moisture. You don't have to take that many typically in a long windrow like this. Temperature is pretty uniform through the whole thing. And so you decide which ones are going to be turned today. Second guy comes in, hops on the turner, sees which windrows have to be turned, gets out there, does the turning. Just about the time the guy taking the temperature finishes up, the guy doing the turning finishes up. And now we're going to go build our new windrows. So going over here, getting our wood chip material, laying it out, get our green, lay it out, get our high nitrogen, lay it out, maybe I'm doing two new rows, depending on what got finished. And then I'm going to go through and I'm going to turn this, the new row, turn that new row. And then I'm going to go to my equipment shed and I'm going to wash my turner. I want it all nice and clean and happy and no garbage caught in the teeth. Because if I take this turner that just went through freshly made compost pile, what's the probability I have human pathogens on those paddles caught in the teeth of my compost turner? You must clean it. That's, again, a big problem I often see in commercial composting. The turner is just chock full of garbage. And then they go out and turn their piles the next morning. How much contamination? Significant. So if you're really going to be making compost with no pathogens, make sure you turn that clean turner at the end of each day. You always start with your oldest piles and work to your youngest. Same thing in your backyard. You know, your shovel that you're building that new pile with? Do not go back to your almost finished pile and start playing with it. Dirty shovel, wash it. That's what your hose is for. Clean it off, let it dry. The surface of a shovel, of a piece of equipment, only has to be dry for about 45 minutes. And the E. coli is pretty much gone. Wash the shovel, let it dry. The E. coli can't tolerate those kinds of conditions. Yeah, just wash it with water. Yeah, water, good stuff. As long as it dries, as long as you've got it clean, then let it dry. And you'll usually get rid of the E. coli or any other pathogen. They're very susceptible to drying. So I was going to mention in this last one, this turner is a Sittler turner. You buy it from Global something or other. if you want the information on this Turner, because I really like these Turners. They do a really good job of pulling your material from the sides into the middle. The material in the middle gets thrown up into the air. They've got great hose watering faucet, and, you know, nozzles up here at the top to wet down all your compost as you turn it. You can adjust the height on your cylinder so you can get it down so it's actually touching on the ground. You do have to have a tractor with a very slow gear. You want a creeper gear that goes like, I think it's 2 to 3 miles an hour.
What's the company again?
It's called Sittler. S-I-T-T-L-E-R. They were really kind to us because they know that I really like their Turners. And so at Rodale, they donated one of their Turners to Rodale. So we're showing just how good a Turner this is. If you can also find another Turner that has all these same features, great, go for it. And like this one, it's a homemade job. You have an extra tractor hanging around? Okay, great. You know, you just have to sling a cylinder across the middle so that you just modify that bed a little bit. Cylinder going out of the middle. You can see that lined up hose, so nice sprayers. Great compost. So good structure. You can see that there's nice air holes and passageways into that compost as they're making it. So great stuff.
Do you know of any incomparable for the home gardener? Smaller versions.
They do make smaller versions. And so Sittler has smaller sizes. Maybe for, you know, somebody who's dealing with only an acre, they probably don't make a unit small enough. Frontier Industrial makes a small unit. So you might check those guys. They're out of Woodburn, Oregon. And they do make a Turner that is 4 feet high, I think probably about 8 feet wide, which would be really fine for small scale growers. It comes with the, you know, the water tank and the hoses and everything else on it. You know, it's but small scale. So if you have, you know, like 40 acres, 30 acres, 10 acres, a couple acres, that would probably be the size Turner that you want to get. Small scale. Well, you know, a lot of times you really want to think about how much compost do I really need. If I've only got an acre of land, I only have to be making a ton of compost. And I'm putting a good inoculum out over that whole acre. Well, still a ton of compost might be more than I actually want to make. So now you start thinking about, is it actually put the compost out, I'm going to put out compost extract, or I'm going to put out compost tea. So calculate how much compost you really have to be making. If in a typical compost tea, we're only using 15 pounds to make 500 gallons of compost tea, and we're putting out 20 gallons of compost tea per acre, you don't need even a ton of compost. Maybe you need a quarter ton, half a ton if you're just gonna go hog wild. Start calculating what you really might not need, and you don't need that much. Question back there? Okay, that's a stretch.
You answered.
So do you guys cover your pilot by hand? Like, you pull over the cover?
There are turners that will lift your cover, and you turn it, and it just goes back down on top of the windrow behind you. So you can buy those, but oh, you pay through the nose for that. So if you're a really large-scale composter, that's worth it. But when you're making smaller size piles, usually two people can flip the context material back over it. A lot of times when I'm making small piles, I just use cardboard and put rebar down on top of it. So cardboard is great stuff because when the fungi start chewing it up, you just turn it into the pile. We put your paper on piles sometimes if that's all you have, and put your paper when it starts breaking up, you just turn it into the pile. Question back there.
So when you're trying to rehabilitate really toxic soils, you would need to put the organic material in there. There's no way to get around making that ton of compost
for your 1 acre or 30 acres, right? You really need to get the material in there. You can't just bypass and go on to extracts or teas if there's nothing for the critters to eat, right?
It's a time question.
Okay.
If there's really not much of anything out there, you could put a tea out with just a huge amount of humic acid in it, and that might take the place of the compost. So you might try that out on some part of your land. And really, if your soil is so bad, mostly what we want to do is get some of those ground cover plants out there and just let them work for a year or two. So a lot of times in California, say, where we're going at, coming out of agricultural land into grapevines, what we're going to do is put in a crop of crimson clover or red clover and have it in clover for at least a year before we go and mow that all down and plant the vines in the next spring. Because it's just impossible on some lands where you're dealing with a crust of salt that's just this thick, and the compaction layers all the way down, and you know you have a whole bunch of methylbromide. From methylbromide is a residue, and your grapevines just can't tolerate that. We got some lead problems in there, we have some arsenic, we have some copper, we have some of those lands are just nightmares. And I'm going to put them into an alternate crop, a nitrogen fixer for at least through that fall, winter, and then plant in the spring with your vines. That's the only way to do it. And you can have teas and compost as much as you can. So you can resuscitate, so you can bring it back without having to put on lots and lots of compost. But then it's going to be a plant that you're going to put into the system, and those plant residues take the place of a good amount of compost, the organic matter that you would add in that compost.
Question? I'm wondering if there are any materials that you modifies for compost covers, like straight plastic, wheat cloth.
When you use black plastic on a compost pile like this, you would need to be a little bit careful about how far down the sides you brought that material. With a group that we worked with in Mexico, we had a nice compost pile that we just made, got it started, and we said, yeah, you can put plastic on there, but when you put the rocks on the side, make sure that you leave breathing space so oxygen, the air can move underneath. So what did they do? Create a big sheet of plastic over the whole things, and they put rocks like every 2 feet. There was absolutely no oxygen getting into that pile at all because they had it tied down with rocks. So the next morning when we came in and we took a look at this compost pile, the plastic was just like a big balloon about to burst. And it was, oh no, get that off of there as fast as possible. So if you're using plastic is not breathable or not breathable at a fast enough rate for any decent microbial growth. So with plastic, you know, okay, you can use a clear plastic or a black plastic, but only put it maybe 3/4 of the way down the sides. And then, you know, maybe tie it down, you know, put bricks or put rebar, put something on there to hold the plastic. But you want these sides so the compost has oxygen that can get in under there. You do not want to seal. Besides in South Africa, with the, look at how neat that black plastic looks. Isn't that nice and tight? Because they've taken all the edges and carefully tucked it underneath. Completely sealed. This smells so bad. It is really, and it's cut the plastic off, you know, about here. So when you can use a plastic, you can use unbreathable materials, but you gotta leave some breathing space in there. Do not seal your oxygen out.
It's almost compost silage.
Yeah, it's turning it into silage. Why do we put, why do we hold silage in essentially anaerobic conditions? What are the preservatives being made if you're in an anaerobic Yeah, so we're making vinegar, we're making formaldehyde, we're making some phenols. Great preservatives. But it doesn't make a compost. Your animals can be a little happy on silage because they're getting all that great alcohol. Drunk cow. Smaller scale. Oh, question. A lot of plants have materials that are called allelopathic. Allelopathic. Which means they contain materials that are toxic. Your alfalfa plant, for example, it makes allelopathic materials to keep anyone else from growing into its root system. It's sort of like, you know, we're sharing some root space and I'm going to go, stay away. Don't, you can't come here. They're preventing the growth of the other plant into their root space. Well, in your alfalfa, if you don't have good biology in your soil, that allelopathic material will accumulate, and in about 2 to 3 years, your alfalfa, all of the alfalfa in your field look really sick, really unhappy, and so people come to the conclusion that you can't grow alfalfa in one place for more than 2 or 3 years. Yeah, right. Get the biology back into your soil and chew up that allelopathic compound. Same thing in compost. Christmas berry, all kinds of plants contain some really toxic materials. Think about eucalyptus. Do you do allelopathic compounds in there? So when you're taking eucalyptus leaves, when you're taking the wood, when you're chipping that up, pine. You know that wonderful pine smell? It's an allelopathic compound. It is antimicrobial. And so when you're taking any of those nice aromatic compounds, they smell wonderful. Do not put very much of that into your pile when it's fresh. You want to chip up that material, put it in a nice little pile, and let all that wonderful aromatic material volatilize. Until you can turn that pile and not smell, oh yeah, that's pine, oh yeah, that's eucalyptus, oh yeah, that's black walnut, any of those kinds of woody materials that have a nice strong smell, make sure it all volatilizes and is gone. Or don't you put more than 5% of that into your pile, maybe 10%.
I got a question. Along those lines, how about the coffee, you know, skin? Would that,
it's great stuff.
Yeah.
Cetane ratio on some of that coffee skin, not the shell itself, but on the coffee skin. It's actually high nitrogen. It has a cetane ratio of about 10.
They don't have that idiopathic.
Not that I'm aware of. I've never had a problem with
it. That's has a hormone, though, you know, that has a fragrance.
Fragrance, but it's not antimicrobial that I've ever seen.
Are you talking about the cold, not the dark?
Who's saying coffee
first? Parchment skin is what I'm talking about.
Okay, yeah, you're talking about the cold. So,
the
dark
is
the cold. How about the cold?
The pulp, what do you mean precisely by the pulp?
The cherry
skin.
The cherry skin? Not right. Now, if you've got a really hard nut, or you know, that hard, like somebody brought in some magnet material today. And so this has been composted, I believe. And I was having fun looking through here. Now, the parchment on a magnet is great stuff, and the microorganisms just love that. But look at this magnet, the nut part, the shell. It has not decomposed one bit. It is lacking fungi in this material. I can tell you that right now. Or that would be decomposing. So, in your wood chip pile, be taking any hard materials like this and crunch it up as much as possible and get that into your wood chip pile so we get these really good fungi chewing on these difficult to decompose really hard materials. So by the time it actually goes into your compost pile, it's already 3/4 on the way towards decomposition. But that nut compost can lead to some of the best stuff. Question.
Yeah, so if you made a brassica compost pile down here for growing brassicas, And you're saying that the organisms can handle quite a bit of a temperature variance, right? They'll do good. What's the reason? I mean, I understand that sourcing it from the sources, near to the source, is good, but why would bringing it up to Waimea and using that compost, would that be fine? Or?
You're probably close enough that the organisms in Waimea are not that different from here.
Yeah.
Now, it's, the times I've found difficulties is when we take compost from California and bring it to Maine.
Okay.
Good luck. You know, or vice versa.
Okay.
Sometimes I will recommend some of the Alaska humus material, just because it has this fantastic fungi in it. Just, wow, really good fungi.
Okay.
Especially in systems where we're having a lot of trouble getting any fungi at all to establish and start to grow. So at least we're getting an inoculum.
And so like in Central Park, where did you source your organism?
From Long Island Compost. We made them make compost under our recipe, under our management. So they learned how to make really good compost, so guess what they're doing with the rest of their operation? I want a royalty fee. Thank you.
I see.
Yeah, yeah. This is all part of making a deal before you get started. I'm going to show you how to make compost, and if you ever make compost the way I've showed you, you owe me money. Make sure you do that. See, I'm not a business person.
Okay. You didn't disclose that when we signed up.
I am so stupid. Okay, so smaller scale composting now, where we're not using big equipment, where we're not trying to make tons and tons and tons. So here we are kind of going over that edge. These, wire frames. Pretty easy. You want to make sure that you're getting wire material that is thick enough that you can actually lean on it. When you're picking up your hardware cloth, and that's what this stuff is called, you're picking up your hardware cloth at the hardware store, wherever, the garden store, wherever you're going, unwind it. Hold it up and make sure you can actually lean all of your weight on that wire material without it collapsing. And if it's too flimsy to hold your weight, you really don't want that stuff. I'd also like to encourage you to get stuff that's maybe a little bit shorter, especially if you're like me and you have a hard time lifting stuff up and turning it. For us women in the room, it might just be easier to get something that's only 4 foot high and not 5. Because that last foot is a real killer. So, you know, you can find fire mesh material. That works perhaps just a little bit better. So less of your stuff falls out in between the big squares. But these size squares work pretty well too. It's really easy to get your hose or your thermometer in through those large mesh squares to be taking your temperatures in the middle of your pile, or you're detecting a dry spot down here, you just shove the hose into the pile and let the water run in there and wet up that dry spot. So here you can see, again, you know, there's our woody layer on the bottom, and then there's our green, and then there's our nitrogen. Now different woody material, so this is wood at the bottom, this is straw. And there's different green layers. These are leaves from the garden that we put in here. And then alfalfa up here on the top, and then we add a little bit more wood chip on the top just to fill it up. So we've layered it in there. We were trying a different recipe here, so slightly different starting materials. Here we were putting in whole fresh vegetables, because when a fresh vegetable decomposes, most of the weight of that item is actually water. And as that breaks apart and releases all the water, you can get a massive release of water, and you can cause all of that material to go completely wet, yucky, anaerobic. Be careful. In these kinds of piles, doesn't seem to be an issue. But if you're ever using a compost tumbler, where, you know, you're basically getting a barrel of some kind, and it's got some kind of turner on it, well, just think about the fact that there's no good airflow. through that tumbler. How are you going to get good oxygen into the tumbler while your organisms are happily having a party in there? Go ahead, have a party. Live it, 150 people, ruckus party inside a sealed semi-tractor trailer. How's going to go anaerobic and go in? Same thing with these tumblers. So if you're going to be using a tumbler, you've got to make sure it's something that's got really good aeration. Well, if your tumbler is going around and around like this and it's got big holes in it, where are all your materials and your compost going to go? So it's just not, I just don't see how that's a feasible system to make the compost. Or you could only have a really tiny, tiny amount of material in the bottom of the closed system. Well, then you're not going to maintain heat. I don't see tumblers really working. There's a lot of people that do the in-vessel composting, where they actually have a pump of some kind that's pulling oxygen through that. The problem with those things is as you're pulling the oxygen through, you're drying your pile. So how do you keep it wet enough? How do you keep it loose enough? It's got a big screw inside of it, and it goes round and round and round and round. And so you're turning a lot to try to keep oxygen moving through this pile while it's pulling and drying. So how are you going to keep enough moisture in there? Constantly adding, constantly having the screw rail go around to keep it aerated. What are you doing to your fungi? What are you doing to your protozoa? Good guy nematodes. Imagine being a nematode inside an in-vessel compost where it's constantly being mixed and turned. Goodbye, and heading for the Gila Hills. Ain't staying in this place. Too many earthquakes happening. So I like these systems. Pretty easy, pretty simple. So we've got this layered in there. We can see we have our layers, our amounts of woody, green, high nitrogen. Typically, then what we do is unclip these. Pull the wire off, set the wire up right next to it, and now we're going to turn. And as we're turning, we're going to take our hose, and we're going to be watering, adding adequate moisture to all of this material as we're turning. When I do this as a one-person job, what I usually do is take my hose and clip it to the top wire. And so as I'm next to it and I'm turning, everything's getting a nice, gentle rain of water, so it's wetting up to the proper level, more or less. So I'm happily turning. I don't turn very fast anymore, because it's a lot of work, and that's why I really like the shorter wire, because I can't lift as high as I used to lift. You know, but it takes you maybe a half hour to turn that pile in back into the wire. You're all ready to go. Quite often with really fluffy materials, you're actually going to have to get into the bin and dump it down. So if you're putting a lot of hay, a lot of straw, a lot of grass material that's not chopped up, you're going to have to turn your 5-gallon bucket upside down, step on it, step in there, and then do the winemaker stump to get that material to come in contact. So you can stomp like this, or you can take that fluffy material and put it in your bucket and get your weed and break it all up, shred it up into a pretty small size. Question.
How soon are you turning this after you've layered it up?
Like right away.
Right away.
Immediately.
Okay, so now,
if you run out of time, you can wait till next morning to turn it.
Yeah, but you want to have it mixed. Like, that's the whole idea, is to mix it straight off the bat.
Yeah, because we want to get the party happening in with woody material and the green, and not just have the party in the high nitrogen stuff. So we want everything to come up to temperature. There we go. You know, somebody else, people we were working with at Sonoma Institute, and you can see this is one of the treatments where we would put the whole vegetables in there. In this kind of situation, having those whole vegetables, letting them decompose and release their water was just, it made controlling moisture a little bit easier, unlike tumblers, where release of the moisture into a tumbler is just fraught with danger.
So
the tadpole vegetables because they were like getting old and they probably had mold on and whatever, and it doesn't really matter if you got some kind of disease things going in there.
Sure. So when we're thinking of what's the quality of the vegetables going in here, these are the things you're going to throw away because they're disgusting. You don't want to eat them. Throw them in your compost pile. So all of these diseases we're going to get rid of because we're going to bring it up to temperature. If we do a cold compost here, we're going to get rid of all these diseases by the digestive system. Which way do you want to compost? Where you're going to take care of the human pathogens, plant pathogens, refeeding nematodes. Has to stay aerobic because, of course, the aerobic organisms that compete with all these diseases and problems have to be aerobic organisms. You have to keep things aerobic. So we have a lot of different ratios of, you know, you can see lots of different recipes that we were testing. And what was interesting to me is that it did not really make any difference whatsoever what the initial mix of food resources were going into or the different. Whether it was wood or if it was straw. And the woody materials, if they're woody materials, the piles come out the same. If we're dealing with green, the piles come out the same. Now, there's one caveat with all of this. Remember that when we were turning this, we're taking the wire off and putting it here, we're taking that shovel and we're doing the turning with the shovel or the pitchfork. When we went to turn the next pile, did we wash the shovel? Did we wash the pitchfork? No. So what were we transferring every time we turned? We're transferring the exact same set of organisms. So every pile got inoculated every time we turned with this inoculant. So all the piles came out the same. Really didn't seem to make much difference. What if we washed the equipment in between? Would we maybe have seen a difference? So do we have more work to do? Yeah. All these subtle little things when we're trying to look at this. My attitude is just let's maximize diversity and then we don't have to fuss about it. So here we are turning the pile. You can see we've taken the wire off, set it up next, and now happily turning. One thing to think about when you're turning is that hot middle of the pile that's finished. The middle of the pile is what got a high enough temperature long enough. That's what's done. So we really want that hot middle on the outsides of the pile. And what we want to do now is make sure that the outside layers here get into the middle. So often what I'll do is take off this top layer. Move, take all that hot middle, put it on the bottom. And then that top part of the pile that's still real cool, hasn't been composted properly, that goes into the middle. And then the bottom goes on the top. Now the next time we turn this pile, we're going to do the same thing. Which means that all of the parts of the pile eventually get into that hot middle. Everything in that pile gets up to high enough temperature long enough. So typically you're going to have to turn the pile at least three times. Organic regs say, and most regulations from the USDA say, five times. Just to be on the safe side, we really probably want to turn the pile with some attention. Make sure that all of the materials get into that hot center at least five times. We don't want to be turning more, because if we turn it more, we're slicing and dicing our fungi. So there's a trade-off. We have to turn to get the materials into the hot part of the pile. If you turn, we're slicing and dicing our fungi, our protozoa, our nematodes. So we do the minimum amount of work. Now, this is a slightly different way to expand your compost. If you've already made good compost. In this particular instance, what Sonoma Mountain Institute had done was to buy some compost from a commercial operation. Now, take a look at that compost. What color is it?
Okay.
Yeah, so, and it's at least steaming away enough, you know, fairly warm morning. When we were working with Sonoma Mountain Institute, a lot of their oak trees were suffering from sudden oak death. And the owner of Sonoma Mountain Institute had said, is there anything that you can do to bring our oak trees back to life? And so we said, well, let's give it a try. And probably five of their oak trees, we went out and we did the pouring around the oak tree at the half in between the drip line and the stem and then out at the drip line. So we put a total of 32 holes, put really good compost tea down those holes, refilled the holes with a mix of 70% sand, 30% really good compost with really good fungi in it. And they came along and drenched the soil around the tree, drenched the foliage of the tree and all the wounds that were seeping from the Phytophthora rumosum, just absolutely soaked, dripping wet. All of those trees recovered, despite the fact that they were almost completely defoliated at the time. They all came back to life. So you can imagine the people at Sonoma Mountain Institute were like, wow, we've discovered the cure. But the trick is, really good compost. So they're starting to make compost. They ordered this stuff. Well, it's got to be really good compost. They told us it was really good compost. All right. Use your microscope and take a look. There's nothing but bacteria in there. Can we resuscitate this stuff? So that's what we're doing, and it's coming out with some good compost tea. And we're going to try to resuscitate, we're trying to put the proper biology back into this mulch material, future organic matter material. So, just to give you an example of how you might want to think about doing that, as a front end loader is turning and it's taking scoops out of the existing pile and starting the new pile, person with compost tea is trying to wet up all of that mulch material as it's being dropped out of the front end loader, trying to get that all wetted up with really good biology. So as he's happily turning, look at the color of the inside of that pile. And I'm standing watching this and just kind of going, oh man. If any of the biology survives this stuff, I'm going to be blown away. And then look at the color. That's just, okay. What was the survival of the organisms into that? It was way too hot compost even sitting there out in the open like this. Nothing survived. So, yeah, you can try to remediate mulch material, but make sure it's mulch material. Nothing that's got really high temperature, nothing that's anaerobic on the inside. Your organisms, when you add them, are not going to survive that anaerobic condition if you're applying them onto something that is anaerobic. Would you pile your compost up like this? And you think it's going to go anaerobic? Spread it out. Let the organisms have a chance to breathe. So this did not work. And they didn't want to go do through all of the work of putting the holes in around the trees, drenching the soil, drenching the top of the tree. They wanted to just drench the top of the tree, and I kept saying, it's not going to work. It's not going to work. You got to do the whole meal deal in order to fix this problem. So they tried it on another 50 trees, and none of them survived. Because you got to do the whole meal deal if you want to bring your plants back to life, the ones that are already starting to defoliate.
So how wide are those holes that you drilled down?
They were probably about an inch and a half, maybe 2 inch holes. Ms. Rebecca?
What was the period of time before you noticed a turnaround in a mature tree?
They were starting to green up in just a couple days. Yeah. Number of people, I can't remember his name. Carol Ann Rollins and I have worked on this fair amount in California. George Hahn is the other person. He's worked with a lot of the municipalities in California on the pine bark more from. He has quite a bit of data, anecdotal, not going to go out into the scientific literature. But he's been showing in a number of municipalities that application of the worm compost tea, but again, to the ground and to the foliage. So pine trees have already defoliated. All of the needles are brown, they're all dead. The arboriculturists are saying just cut the trees down, there's nothing you can do. And he'll go out and apply the compost around the trunks of the trees, and then he'll spray the trees with good worm compost, compost tea, and within just a couple of days, the needles are starting to green up, and the plant recovers. He did one experiment in forget the name of the town. Novartis? That's not right.
Novato,
California. And he told the city workers to go out to this area of the park where all the pine trees were dying. And he put up yellow tape where he wanted them to spray all of the trees inside that yellow tape zone. And so, you know, he gives them the tea. They go out and spray the tea, they come on back and they say it's done. And like 3 days later, he takes the mayor and everybody out to this plot. And they're looking at the trees. And the only trees that are greening up are the ones that are right along the tape line. And George was just like, I've never seen this happen before. If they spray the tea, they all should be greening up. Why are the ones just where the yellow tape is? And it's exactly what you were saying. The workers only sprayed the tree that were right next to the yellow tape. They didn't spray any of the trees inside here. So it's kind of a good demonstration of, can we do this? Yeah, it's only the trees that were getting the tea that were coming back to life. James Sotillo has done this in East Hampton. So this is working East Hampton on Long Island. This is one of the snootiest towns you want to talk about. We work on a number of celebrity properties out there, but all of the elm trees in the city of East Hampton were condemned because they all had Dutch elm disease. And by law in the state of New York, if you have an elm with Dutch elm disease, you must cut it down and you must burn all of that tree. And so an arboriculturist came out and he said all of the elm trees lining the streets of East Hampton had to be cut down and destroyed because they all had Dutch elm disease. Well, the Ladies Garden Club of East Hampton, what did they think about that? Oprah did not think that was a viable thing to do. So they provided the money to take out all of the concrete underneath the trees, because of course all these elm trees completely surrounded by concrete along the, you know, the edge of the streets. Took out all of that concrete and replaced it with replaceable brick barriers, so you could just pull the brick up, inject down into the ground, put the brick back so it remained pretty and everything. And right around each one of the trees, there was actually open soil with a cute little metal garden fence around it. So nobody would actually walk on it, except all the, you know, all the dogs. A little extra nitrogen. As long as you're putting good compost tea out, it doesn't matter if your dogs pee on stuff, because we'll take care of the damage that they do when they pee. And so in those, with each one of the trees, nice little fence around it, we could inject into their root system all the way around it. Of course, the road's right here. The center main street is right out there. Dutch elm disease works by the adult beetle landing on the tree, drilling its way through the bark of the tree, and then in between the bark and the cambium, drills a bunch of galleries. And at the end of each gallery, it lays a whole bunch of eggs. While it's drilling the gallery, it leaves behind the fungus that's what's going to kill your plant. So the fungus it leaves behind is something called ceratocystis, blue stain fungus. So it inoculates all those galleries because that is the only thing that the larvae eat once those eggs hatch. It's the only thing they will eat, the only thing that they will stay alive, mature enough to come on out and adult beetle fly to the next tree. Well, of course, while they're eating, when the eggs are laid, the fungus starts growing throughout the cambium of your wood, and it plugs up the cambium, the phloem, and the xylem gets completely plugged up. Water from the ground can't get up above. Photosynthesis from up above can't get down to your tree, so the tree dies eventually. So, how do you stop this process? We wanted to make sure that we had really good sets of organisms, those things that will crawl up the trunk of your tree, those things that will move into those galleries and coexist inside the galleries to taxicab those organisms that will attack and consume the ceratocystis. So we made sure really good compost down in here. We were injecting really good biology into the root systems because those have to be healthy trees. And then we absolutely doused the outside of the tree with compost tea till it was dripping wet. So the whole entire tree just dripping. You don't know how many people stop and say, "What are you doing to our trees? Is that pesticides?" Okay. And what happened was all the little spiders, all the little creepy crawlies, all the little micro-arthropods moving up and down the mountains crawled into these galleries and spread the biology that attacked, consumed, and inhibited the ceratocystis. When the larvae, when those eggs hatch, there's nothing for them to eat. They all die. And we shut down the Dutch elm problem. A year later, we invited the same arboriculturist to come out and take a look at these trees and give his health report. And he came out and he looked at the trees and he said, "There's no Dutch elm. It's amazing that we have any populations of elm left in the state of New York. This is really great that you don't have any Dutch elm disease. It's fantastic." So we took his report from the previous year, showed it to him, and showed him the report from this year, and said, "So, we got rid of the Dutch elm. We know now how to solve this problem." And he looked at the two reports and he goes, "Oh, no, last year, I just must have made a mistake." Irrigates, you know, it's like, man, we want to go out there and tell everybody that we have a way to sell, save the elm trees. So we want to carry news to people that most of these fungal diseases in trees are in fact something you can deal with. You just have to get the right biology to protect your plant for you. Had a lot of controversy at the University of California, Berkeley, with those people who want to promote a chemical solution to oak death. And I can tell you some horror stories about all of that too, but let's go on with compost.
So about that sudden oak death, on those you said you had to drill holes down in the ground, like 32 inches or something?
Not on the sudden oak death. I'm still on Dutch elm. Sudden oak death, we did the typical injection, and then the holes where you put the compost, the mix, 70% sand and 70% compost, 30% compost down into the ground. And at the typical halfway between the stem and the drip line, we did 8 holes around the tree, and then out at drip line, we put 16 holes, because these are honking big trees. These are not little babes.
The depth of the hole?
Remember, it was probably more like 3 feet, 4 feet somewhere, because we just can't punch it down that far. Could we have gone deeper? That would have been great, but we didn't. So 4 feet, probably no more than 4 feet. Just get the inoculum into the soil, in the root system area, so you support the growth of that plant. But it's the compost. It's the organisms that are important. Question?
So with Dutch elm, I'm just trying to compare this to something that I've done. With Dutch elm, does it kill off sections of branches at a time, or does it just get the whole tree all at once? My situation has to do with circulation also, but the whole tree doesn't die, just a section of the tree.
If what you're looking at is just like one branch, every year you've got one, two branches that are going, that's typically more a symptom of a root rot disease. Your roots are slowly but surely getting taken over by something like malaria. Agamosis kind of problem. And there's where you want to try to figure out, it's that branch, so most like it's this section of my roots, and so I would probably want to localize my cores and my drenching into that part, that portion of the root system of your plant.
But it would never hurt to do the whole thing.
It would never hurt to do the whole thing. Absolutely, just make the whole plant healthier.
Thank you.
So now I showed you the hardware pump version of making your compost piles. This is another really nice, tidy way to make compost. These are plastic boxes, basically, with air vents in the side, air vents in the tops. And so when you start layering, you put your woody on, and then you put your next layer. There goes your green, your next layer, and here's your high nitrogen, your woody, your green. And so you can stack these containers up as high as you want to take them. These, I think, are made by Smith and Hawkins. And so this is Elaine Weber's operation in California. So I think I talked about Elaine yesterday, so you've got her name. There it is, putting a thermometer to the middle of the pile and checking what the temperature, wind you have to turn. So thermometer taking at least 3 week readings inside, so you're getting hot and cold spots, making sure that compost is just uniformly heating up, grabbing moisture samples, making sure you're up to high enough moisture and uniform moisture in the pile. If, as you're digging down to take your moisture, you're only seeing a layer of bacteria, any of those things could be reasons to turn the pile. So they can make things homogenous, get it cooled, get oxygen back in there. So there's a laying, turning pile. So the pile, you know, was high, stacked higher, and all she did was put that first layer down next to it and starts turning into it. As she fills up the next, as she fills up that bottom one, she takes the emptied square and puts it over and then fills. So it's a really easy, pretty tidy make to keep your compost and know exactly what has to be turned and what's outside the pile and not getting any contamination in there. Elaine gives classes in Southern California, so she's pretty good at all of this too.
How does that air get into this?
There are air vents, so all the way along here, see that line right there? There's an air vent. And then there's another air vent right in there and there. So pretty good air movement, air flow in there. Now, this does not dry out anywhere near what the one with the hardware cloth. So water can be a bit more of an issue in these kinds of systems because there's not as much drying, there's not as much removal of the moisture because you're not getting as good airflow. So you may have to be a little bit more careful when you're doing these things, but you learn pretty fast what to do and what not to do. So you've got to make sure that you're not getting rain inside of these things too. So when you've got air holes here at the top of your, you can get rain coming in the top. So I think she puts the tarps over, especially when it's a real rainy time in that part of the world. So she lives just south of San Francisco. It can get pretty rainy, and you've got to prevent water from moving into your compost. So covering things at times that's really necessary. Making sure you're not getting water seeping up from the ground. You have to make sure your compost pile is not in a hole or a divot where that's filling up, no puddles. Moving on to worm compost bin. You can do batch cultures with your worm compost. So a bin like this, and I'll get a nice plastic bin from Woolies or Walmart or Kmart or something. You would want to put air holes, and what Mary Applehoff does is to build a corner side and put a PVC pipe through there, and the PVC pipe has little air holes in it, so you're getting good aeration down here at the bottom of the container. I usually then take my drill bit and put a whole bunch of holes in the bottom of this container. And heck, while you're at it, put holes on the side too. It's not going to hurt anything to have more airflow in at the bottom of this unit. Those of you who might like to learn more about the physiology of worms and different kinds of worms and those kinds of things, this book by Mary Applehoff is a really good one. Worms Eat My Garbage. So just Google Worms Eat My Garbage and have some fun learning more about worms. Larger worm bins. So this is a flow-through system. The idea here is the bottom of this bin is just a wire with big holes. Up above that wire, you have a knife that's pulled through by a motorized system. You have a little gear, a little motor, and it pulls the knife along, and it cuts off the bottom half inch, three quarters inch of your finished worm compost. Dumps it on the ground so you can see where that blade is moving along and it's dumping the compost down. It will continue along through to the end. When you're dealing with a bin that has that deep a layer of worm compost, there's no way you can take a knife and cut that. You have to have a motorized system to cut that worm compost. So my attitude is, why make the bin that deep? Make it shorter. Only half of that height would be a good idea. You just really don't have to leave it that deep. So the way the worm bin goes is your mix of starting materials, and you can, if you want to, put pure manure at the top, but you really want to make sure that you've heated that manure and gotten rid of the weed seeds. Or you can use just pure vegetable material. Or you can use a mix of vegetable and woody. Usually what I try to do is a mix of 50-50 green and woody material. The more variation, the more diversity, the better it is. And you just layer that on the top of your bin, which pulls the worms up to the top to eat the bacteria, fungi, protozoa, nematodes, microarthropods, all those good things growing on the food. Earthworms don't make the enzymes to decompose organic matter. It is the bacteria and fungi that are doing that decomposition, and the worms eat the bacteria, fungi, protozoa, nematodes, microarthropods. So the worms are up here, they're happy to chew away. The worms incorporate all that organic matter into the top layer of the worm bin. You do not put any more food on your worm bin until they finish their last meal. Oh, poor little babies, they're starving to death. No way. How many bacteria and fungi are in that compost material? Protozoan, other things was actually growing in there.
Really?
Worms have years and years and years of food in that worm bin. So you forget about them for a month or two. They just happily chew through and keep eating and keep recycling and just make your worm compost better and better and better. And then you come back and you feed them. So you put a layer of food on the surface such that they completely consume, incorporate, shred, get that moved and mixed into the worm compost, nice smooth surface, and you do not put any more food on until they finish their last meal. Or you're going to have fruit flies. You're going to have maggots. You're going to have fungus gnats. It's really fun when you open the lid of your compost pile and out comes a billion fruit flies, and you eat them, and they get all of your food at the dinner table, and they join your bananas and lay eggs all over everything. What's so terrible about fruit flies on your food? Where were they walking last? And they could be bringing pathogens to walk all over your food. Not good at all. So the trick with the worm compost is to not overfeed it. Don't overwater it. There are people who like to talk about worm tea. The only thing we should be calling worm tea is when you take worm compost, put it in a container, and make a compost tea out using that worm compost, completely separate from a bin like this. When people say they are collecting a leachate coming out of their bin, and this is constantly dripping, what does it tell you about the quality?
Anaerobic.
So putting that worm tea onto your plants could well be extremely detrimental. Now people will make worm leachate, because you could put some water over the surface, let that water move through and collect water that comes out the bottom. Great, fine, that would be a good worm leachate. Doesn't have any organisms. It has some great humic acids. It has some nice hormones. It has some good enzymes. But it's only a food for your organisms. It's a few enzymes. How long does a single enzyme actually continue to work? A few hours, that's it, no more. So you would have to let your bin compact to 70% moisture. If you do that little trick of leaching out some of the good stuff that's in there, and if you leach out the good stuff that was in there, now what does that say about the quality of your worm compost? It went. So maybe we don't want to do that. So a few examples. Have you been listening to Elaine well enough? Would you want to buy this material? Somebody told you that this was their finished compost. Would you buy it?
Yeah.
Look at that black streak. What does that mean?
That's
yeah, it went anaerobic. You don't know if it went anaerobic in a compost pile or when they piled it over here saying this is finished compost. But it's certainly not something I want to buy. Would I buy this mulch? I don't like you that. What's this over here? Yeah, so if I was going to buy this, it better be one on some brassicas. I wouldn't want to put it on anything else. So brassicas, like the actinobacteria, these organisms prevent the growth of your mycorrhizal fungi. So light, ashy material, you pick this up, it's just that piece of organic matter that comes. Those actinobacteria strands aren't strong enough to hold anything else. When you pick it up, all the strands break, and you're left holding just this ashy white material, actinobacteria. Good for brassicas, but not for anything else. So a pile like this, if you're digging into your pile to take your moisture reading, and you encounter a bare actinobacteria like this, I would probably say you could just start a group. It's hopeless. The middle of your pile is going to be black, anaerobic. You've turned all this stuff into wide carbon and nitrogen ratio materials. Use it as woody material in your pile. But what if you start digging into your pile and this white ashy layer is just starting? It's a real narrow layer.
Stir it.
Stir it. Get it turned, got oxygen back in there, and you'll probably be okay. Ooh. Black stuff. And look at these fungal colonies.
Fuzzy wuzzies
and gray and kind of disgusting looking, right? This is mildew. Growing mildew in the organic matter. This is an operation in Canada that I was called in to help them. And this is one of those cases where they didn't want to scrape the teeth on their turner. On the ground, and so they were missing the bottom 2 inches of their compost pile, and this is the material from those bottom 2 inches. Chock full of E. coli, Salmonella, Shigella, human pathogens galore, and some really nasty plant pathogens at the same time. You would have to hope that they would never have sold this to anybody.
That
was part of their own land.
Is that filamentous fungus? Is that
It is filamentous. If you look at this underneath the microscope, all of these strands are going to be very narrow, about 2 micrometers in diameter and totally clear. So remember when we looked before at those nice thick strands of fungal hyphae, nice strands? So remember how much thicker they are? This is what I mean by fuzzy wuzzy, where it's kind of diffuse, it's not solid. If you pick up a good fungus, you can take that strand of fungus and the whole thing comes with it, and it's kind of like playing with latex. Those are good fungi. Now this, if you try to pick this up, it would just kind of disintegrate, fall apart. You're not going to get any solid strands. Bad guys. Scary. So pay attention to your compost. Good compost or not? This is the test.
It's pretty good.
It's got a nice aggregate structure. That's kind of what I really like, is real good structure. So bacteria and fungi are starting to do their thing. We've got really nice air passageways, hallways, living rooms, dining rooms, kitchens for microorganisms. I want to see this kind of aggregation starting to happen within that first week. If I can get this going, if you can get this going, and you don't have to worry as much about whether the middle of your pile is going anaerobic or not. You've got air passageways to deal with that. If it's all kind of crumbled and collapsed and you can't see any solid air passageways like this, I would really worry about what's going on in the middle of my pile. I would expect with this that I'm going to get that actinobacterial layer right close to the top of my pile because we can't get good oxygen in here. Where's the air passageway? Where's the hallway? I want to see the structure being built so your organisms are helping you out in your effort to keep your compost pile fully aerobic. So we talked about this. Aerobic decomposition. Well, the only thing I missed out on is decomposition. What do we mean by decomposition? It means we've got to have all of the critters. You know, oxidative is got to remain aerobic. Decomposition, by definition, means that you have to have bacteria and fungi. You can't decompose anything adequately if you don't have those sets of organisms. And then all of our nutrients would end up to our bacteria and fungi, and decomposition would stop if we don't have the protozoa, nematodes, be great for some arthropods now. So there's a lot of information in that simple definition of compost, aerobic or oxidative decomposition of a mix of organic matter. There's a lot of implicit information in that definition, so remember that, please. Healthy food web, we gotta have that healthy food web so we can have all of these benefits. But most of you were here for the first 3 days, so I'm just gonna zoom through them. We have our microscopes, we're gonna be working on those tomorrow, so we can learn what each one of these things look like, how to assay for it, so make sure that you actually got them in your compost pile. Does compost have a food web in soil? Not really. Most of the organisms that are going to be in your soil are going to be in your compost because you're taking the organic matter growing on your property and making compost out of it. Now, what kills the bad guys? Temperature being consumed by earthworms. So thermal compost, I think we've been through all of this. I don't think I have to go through it. Worm compost is the worms that turn the pile. Your worms that are doing that work for you. In a thermal pile, you have to turn it. Worm compost, your worms do it. So put your worms to work for you. Up to you which one you want to do. Question?
I've seen whole designs for actually like catching like leachate. Now there's whole worm bins like stacking towers that have My friend has one of those and I've always kind of questioned it after smelling the leachate, right? I'm like, well, I guess that's supposed to smell like that. I mean, because he swears by it that it's helping his plants and everything. So, I mean, could it be helping the plants at all? I mean, or is it just something that's really going on with it?
It's the
Yes, kind of your cleaning with fire.
Yeah.
When you're taking that material, you're coming across, especially if it smells bad.
So people just need to be re-educated on acceptance.
Yeah.
What if you leach it?
That leachate should only come out occasionally.
Yeah.
It should not be coming out all the time.
Yeah, because he's pouring off like a half hour every day.
And he's reducing the quality of the compost that's left behind in that bin.
Is it
drying
stuff?
Question?
What if your leachate has no smell? Because yesterday I just pulled my side. It just goes with rain or I put newspaper, but I use a spare leaf to start with. But if it doesn't smell?
You want to look at it in your microscope. And so I bring some tomorrow. Let's take a look at what's in there, and if there really isn't a lot of biology in there, and we've just got cubic acid mixture, great. And then we probably want to look at your compost that's down on the bottom, and you'll see that your compost is really in pretty good shape. But he's got that really anaerobic, stinky, smelly stuff. I bet he's got distillates, he's got some diseases, he's got some not so wonderful in there.
The compost from the worms, is that what you would apply, or how would you use it?
Sure. Yeah. Well, of course, I'm going to use the worm compost, and so how do you harvest worm compost?
I separate it from the worms.
Remember, when we were looking at the batch culture, sorry, we aren't taking, I guess we're not taking a break because nobody stopped me.
Let's take up 10 minutes.
Okay.
5 minutes.
5 minutes.
5 minutes.